Good morning. God is good.
All the time.
God is good. You are welcome to service today. If today is your first time of visiting us, we would love to see you again and again and again. And if you look to the left or the right side of your chairs, you would see this black, how do you call it, file or something of that sort. Please put down your name, your contact details, and if today is your first time, our church staff will be in touch. I don't know, this is not my first time doing this, but anytime I come here to do this, my heart keeps beating within every second. I don't know why, but well, my name is Dr. Sanabre, and I am privileged to be your worship leader this morning. And we also have these prayer cards behind the chairs or in front of you. This is a praying church, and in prayer, we prevail. So please, if you have any prayer request, please put it in here. You can also make it confidential. We also encourage any time giving or any time pledge. So at any moment in your life, you feel called to give or feel called to stop giving, please fill out an information form online or just pick one of the cards and then put it in here. As usual, we know that anytime Sundays people come to do worship leading, they give some, I don't know if it's encouraging verse, motivational verse. But for me, I like to dance, even though I see myself as someone who can't dance. And I also love to sing, even though I have a horrible voice. But one thing is that I love hymns, because if I am not singing the hymns and I'm reading them, they are kind of prayer to me. So we sang this hymn last week, "To God Be the Glory." And I'm going to take my time and read it for us to listen to the words. Maybe sometimes we just see the songs projected up here, but we really don't take notice of what we say, the importance or the impulse of the message we are saying. So to God be the glory, great things he has done. So loved he the world that he gave us his son, who yielded his life, our redemption to win, and opened the life gate that all may go in. O perfect redemption, the purchase of blood, to every believer, the promise of God, the vilest offender who truly believes, that moment from Jesus a pardon receives. Great things he has done, great things he has done, and great our rejoicing through Jesus the Son. But purer and higher and greater will be our wonder, our transport when Jesus we see. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son and give him the glory, great things he has done. Let us prepare our hearts for worship.
Church.
Good morning.
As you're able, let's stand and sing together.
Mm-hmm. go and find someone and say, peace be with you. My name is.
Please remain standing and join in affirming our faith. I believe in God, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of sins, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
Thank you.
us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you this day, for your word says, you bless a cheerful giver. We pray that as this offering bowl goes around, bless every heart, bless every hand that touches it and that puts something in it. We thank you in the name of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen.
You may be seated. What a brilliant, beautiful morning it is. And yes, he touched us in majesty to the name. But how wonderful is Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. And what a mission week. We're wrapping up. Greetings from San Antonio, where our mission team has made it safely home. And as they were worshiping and serving and experiencing fellowship with us, with our neighborhood, with friends everywhere, they just give their regards this morning and goes into the prayers of the people, for the people. They said it was another year of very special experiences, and you never know what happens when San Antonio and Las Cruces come together to be in mission, but it was truly a blessing. And I continue to add to that thank you for everybody who was involved in making this a successful week, whether you served in vacation Bible school or you were cooking a meal or you were standing in the gap and helped us with security, whether you prepared a present for the mission team on their way out or just were there to help to hear these youngsters and their leaders and to hear our neighbors and their leaders and to embrace each other in a beautiful tapestry of being together. He touched us. Jesus Christ. I bring greetings from the family of our friend who passed in the garden a week ago. They're in Zacatecas right now to bring the body back to his home place, his family, his tribe where they came from. But we had a beautiful celebration in the garden together with a block party on Friday before everybody would go back in their mission field also. And just the signs of love and peace that came from our congregation, including bringing meals to the neighbors, to our new friends of Arturo Carrillo, as we learned his name, was very, very touching, and I'm proud of this church, so thank you for that also. And now let us continue to be in prayer. So, Heavenly Father, as we are in your house celebrating Pentecost time, understanding a little bit better what it means to be adopted into your family, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we give you thanks for such a long list of events, of encounters, of just seeing your signs of love and transformation in this world. Sometimes we do not ask for what happens when we get in mission, but we truly know that you are present, that you guide us and walk us and don't bring anything unexpected for you. And that's the comfort, so that we can walk and work through you. You promised us a new heart and a new mind and a new soul. And what we learned, especially this week, your strength, so that we don't have to walk within our own capacity of knowledge and strength and wisdom and heart, that we can lean on you and be guided and work through your strength. And that's what we did the last week. Whether we were doing our own agendas in our families, in our neighborhoods, or whether we were deeply involved in all the events that were happening around this church, we're so grateful for partnerships for UUMC San Antonio and UUMC Las Cruces. We're so grateful for 80 high schoolers and their leaders being in mission, going to New Mexico and said, we want to learn, we want to see your face, and they truly did. Thank you for that. We're grateful for all the ones who are stepping up here, for the neighbors who found a place where the children said, can we come back next week? And that's success, oh God. For more than 60 families in this neighborhood who got touched not just by a babysitting vacation Bible school, but by truly seeing and living by the vibes of your Holy Spirit, so that they walked around and tried to be a little bit like the high schoolers from San Antonio and the leaders from our church and said, this is a place maybe I want to come back to, and Mom and Dad, you need to come to the block party, and they did. We thank you for everybody who, from preparing cookies to being there to watching that everything was prepared and done properly, were present, your church, your flock, so that we were able to transform the world, T-O-W, that we were towing not by our own power, but by your guidance, O God, and that you kept us safe and on track with your message. Lord, we know that there's so much more going on in this world, that joy and life and death and hope and comfort and shock are so close together sometimes. Sometimes that we feel like we can't even bear it, but you have to carry it, and you surely did. I thank you for comforting our new friends, the Carrillo family here in the neighborhood, as they learned about a new place, a new iglesia, Católica, one church for everybody, where we live what we say, where we love on each other, and where we will continue to carry the soreness, the comfort, the weariness, everything together in your spirit. I thank you for our garden, a saving grace, for the premises, for the parking lot, for the building. I thank you for our preschool teachers as they're coming back in the building to start a new school year next week, and their leader. I thank you for the families who word to mouth are telling other families there is a preschool that you can enroll your kids in where they're not just teaching something but a Christian curriculum, and their kids will be safe. I thank you for everybody who was in and out of this building in prayer, watching over each other, taking care of the ones who are at home, the ones who are hurting, the ones who are recovering, the ones who are healing. Making that one call to a person that they haven't seen for a long time in church. And staying in contact with the ones who had to move on to be closer to their families. What a list, oh God. But you said, I'm here. I knew the plans before you could even open your mouth. And that's a good thing, oh God. Forgive us where we failed. Forgive us where we leaned back on our own comfort and strength and fell short. Forgive us where we didn't keep the household the way you wanted it to be ruled. And let us learn anew to walk by joy and by your power as you touched us. I pray this morning especially for Sonia, for Norma, Ellen, and Frank, for the family and friends of Ren. I pray for Jaylene, for Sue, for Bill and Jackie, for all the family and friends of the Correa family. Pray for Annabelle, for Joellen, for Marjorie, and Paul. All these prayers, O God, I summarize in the prayer that you have taught us as we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. So, would you pray with me? Lord, may the meditations of our hearts and the words of my mouth be acceptable in your sight. Our Lord, our Rock, and our Redeemer. Amen. I was doing something for my family yesterday. My youngster brought to my attention that he still needed some new shorts. Mom, you promised. So what we don't do on Saturdays, we went shopping. And as I'm sitting there in front of the fitting room at Marshall's, I watch the families and I suddenly know, why is everybody shopping today? Did they all get the news? Oh, school starts again on Monday. So school closed shopping, and I watched especially the young father, single father by himself with his two daughters, maybe fourth, fifth grade. And he had all the patience in the world as they were trying on shoes. But Dad, I want these shoes. And they work really good when I try, look how I run with them. And he watched them. And then he looked at the price tag, and then he worked looking at the other ones, and the other daughter came and said, I found a second pair of shoes. I'll pay for that with my own money. And what touched me the most is when they were done with that and they got it all right, which ones are good for school, because you need new sneakers for school, they walked the other aisle, and Dad said, and now we need one pair of shoes for church. You should have seen me smiling in front of my feet, and I kept my mouth shut. To tell you the truth, I think Mary, the one we're going to hear about in a minute, she had something about shoes and feet too. You'll see it later, but there was something about, whenever you hear Mary, it's something to do with feet and shoes. I wonder what kind of shoes she was wearing, do you know? I mean, sandals, maybe it was high heels, maybe it was Texas boots, they didn't have Texas boots back then. Maybe it was sneakers, but she must have known that it's very important to wear the right shoes for what she was into. And I'm absolutely positive if she would have not chosen to become, or was chosen to become a disciple, one of the disciples of Jesus Christ, she probably would have picked what she thought when she was a little girl, when she was in fourth grade. One day I'm going to be a podiatrist, a foot doctor. Or if that wouldn't have worked out, she probably would have picked, I'm going to be a cross-country athlete. Someone who can run the marathon, because she knew that feet make you not only be stable and strong, but make you walk and go the race all the way. And for that, obviously, you need good shoes. But we're going to go to that, hopefully, at the end of my sermon. And let's ask Dorcas, would you lead us into the passage for this Sunday? The scripture reading from Luke 10. And you're very much familiar with that one.
Now, as they went on their way, he entered a certain village where a woman named Martha came to welcome him into her home. She had a sister named Mary, who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to what he was saying. But Martha was distracted by her many tasks, so he came to him and asked, "Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to do all the work by myself? Tell her then to help me." But the Lord answered her, "Martha, Martha, you are worried and distracted by many things. There is need of only one thing. Mary has chosen the better part, which will not be taken away from her." The word of God for the people of God.
Not again. I see it in your face. That's an old subject, especially in this church. Mary versus Martha, right? What do you think? Are we a Mary church or a Martha church? Both? Okay, good deal. President of the United Methodist Women, you must have studied it. But there's a lot of doors in this church, correct? Right? Martha's, Martha's, it's the old discussion. We went through it how many times? What's more important, to serve or to worship? Actio or contemplatio? Contemplative, worshiping, prayer, sitting in front of a candle, versus doing, aprons on, and let's go and get the job done. How many times did we discuss it, Lottie? 100 times, right? It's an old story, and Martha's bringing it up again in front of Jesus because she's headed. She was on her heels all day long. Her feet are tired at the end of the day, and so she has a little talk with Jesus to bring it to his attention because, excuse me, gentlemen, but men sometimes don't know what has to be done behind the scenes, right? Jesus! And the answer she's getting is, "Martha, Martha." It always gets a little bit interesting when God in the whole Bible is telling your name twice, right? Moses, Moses, right? Simeon, Simeon. Jacob, Jacob. Oh, no, Martha, Martha. To tell you the truth, this is for everybody who's sitting here who either knows someone or is the person, him or herself, who's doing the same thing that Martha's doing. I know people who are heroes in this flock. They're taking care of a loved one, either a spouse or a child, grandchild, or a mother. Father, and they're on their heels. They know exactly what Martha's talking about. It's about everything. You're not only just doing the laundry at 10 o'clock at night because there's no time during the day, but you also the next morning are responsible for the oil change in the car. Nobody taught you that. And then there is this bill came in from the insurance and you don't even know what this is about, but it scares you. And in the meantime, you need to keep this non-anxiety, we got this, right, face for everybody because you're working for 2 or 3 at the same time. It's scary. It's tiring. And once in a while, you wish just that someone would at least acknowledge it, that you could talk to someone about it, what just is going on in your life, and that sometimes you feel completely incompatible. Capable? Is that the right word? Capable. Incapable for doing what you're called to do. Tired. We're not talking burnout. You need to know that Martha, the meaning of the word Martha, is not the gray little mouse behind the oven. Martha means, it's Aramaic, means the lady of the house. It's a mistress. It's someone, I see her in front of me like the lady's southern hospitality. Both feet on the ground, come on in, and the tablecloth is ironed. Sit on down, and she knows where the lemonade is, and it's made with ice perfect. She got it. She got standards. She's educated. She's not shy. She's courageous. She knows her stuff, but she also knows that it's going a little bit out of whack in the midst of it. She's the one who invited Jesus in and said, come on in, right? Have a seat. But now they're having this little conversation. Martha. And straight out, I mean, Martha is not shy. Later, she will tell Jesus. Remember when the brother dies, Lazarus? That's a little bit later. She would tell him and said, don't go in there. He's been dead for 4 days. It stinks in there. She tells him the truth all the time. But at that moment, she kind of said, don't you care that Mary's not helping? Can't you tell her to come and help me? And it would have been easy, right? By the way, I don't even think that Mary is at the place at that time. It doesn't say it. This is Martha and Jesus. Probably standing in the kitchen. I can see Jesus in the meantime having the dish towel and drying off the dishes while they're talking with each other right there. Mary's not there. She's probably out there on another mission trip for Jesus, right? You know, some people do the nice stuff, right? And we're sitting at home. You know what I'm talking about? Some are handing out the waters and sitting down with the San Antonio team, and the other ones will be the ones who are scraping later the pans in the kitchen, Bob, right? Was it you this time or Ed? At 10 o'clock? Some are working behind the scenes, doing the housekeeping. We lived for a short period in transition times in a hotel in Puerto Rico before we got our housing. And so every time, every day, I hear that knock on the door, and this lady would say, housekeeping. And I didn't know English very well. I had no clue what she was up for, right? Housekeeping. Keeping the house together. What a word you have in your language. She's housekeeping, keeping it together. When all the nice stuff's done, while Mary is running around out there doing the fun stuff. Martha. I wish Jesus would have said, let me take care of that. You're right, and thank you so much for bringing it to my attention. And I'll call her right now, you know, and she has her cell phone on, and then we'll bring her here, and then we'll do this together, and we're good. That's fair. But he's not. Sorry. Instead of that comes this sentence, Martha, Mary has picked the better part. I'm very relieved this morning, and I can prove it to you later. That's the first time in my career that I understand why I had to study Greek for becoming a pastor. It doesn't say it in there. It doesn't say the better part. I can prove it to you. What Jesus is saying in the original Greek text is, Martha, Mary has picked the good part. Did you hear that? Mary has picked the good part. That's a relief. Because the last thing I want when I'm there at 10 o'clock and I'm starting to speak up a little bit to Jesus is to hear that she's even better by not doing the job. That's not what it says there. Did you hear me? Martha, Mary has picked the good part. And now he's going in the details. Watch this. You need to know who Mary was. I see her as the little sister of Martha, but I can't prove that. She's so different. You know how sisters sometimes are different? Whereas Martha is the one, she wakes up in the morning, she has the 10 points on her list that she needs to accomplish. There's no other way how to do it and how to make it through the days. There's Mary, and Mary is just impulsive. Do you know what the word Mary means? Mary, is there any Marys in here? Mary stands for, watch this, the rebellion, right? Any Marys here? Impulsive. The one from the sea. Ooh, the sea is the thing that you can't control, right? She's just everywhere. She's following her heart. She can do what she's called at the moment. Maybe she didn't get that education. She definitely is not that Southern hospitality lady with both feet on the ground who's first going to see how much can I really carry. She's just going to go for it. Oh, she has picked the good part, the part that Mary needs. Do you understand? Because Mary needs to sit at the Master's, and here it comes, feet. Because Mary would be in trouble unless she would come and sit at the Master's feet. Martha, Martha, Mary has picked the best part of all her impulsive, rebellious, whatever I can do out there. She needs to sit at my feet. Otherwise, she wouldn't make it. She would not survive. That's what Jesus' message is first to her. You need to know that sitting at the Master's feet, that's the place for a learner, a disciple, right? You sit there at his feet and then you take notes. Yeah? You're trying to comprehend and understand and adore a little bit and give feedback. Did I get you right about this one? Yes. And then you take another note on that. That's the place for a disciple. Mary has become a disciple. That's hilarious, right? Mary, the one who can't sit still for 3 minutes, right? That's the good part about Mary. Martha, your sister is at the right spot. It's not the story about the prodigal son, you know, the older sister, right? The older brother who's always home, and there is little brother floating around in the world. There's little sister everywhere. Jesus, can't you tell her to help me? It's not this story. It's a story about what do we do with the Marys. Marys need to sit down at the feet of Jesus. Because that's where the learners sit. And I can see her. Can you see her? She's all over the place. But now she's studying the feet of Jesus. Excuse me. That sounds funny, right? Awkward. She probably thinks of what is the shoe size of Jesus. And I don't mean that funny, because one day she may need that. One day God's going to call her to say, could you walk in the shoes of Jesus? Would you follow the footsteps of Jesus? Mary, the rebellion, that's hilarious, right? That's why she needs to be right there, Martha. She can't be in the kitchen. I need her right there, you know? You know, you put the one kid in, where's the teachers here? The one that needs the attention the most, you put it in front of your desk, right? That's where Mary needs to be. And she did. Sitting at the feet of Jesus, having a conversation, conferencing, what the Methodists would do, just like you and I do right now, Martha. You know, while we're drying the dishes. And where does this go? Oh, over there. Yeah, okay. Yeah. Jesus with an apron on. Mary has picked a good piece. She had to, because she needs it for later. It's life-saving. John Wesley would put it that way. He said you need to have personal holiness, being as close as you can with the teacher, adoring and worshiping and praying to him, so that you can have the social holiness, that you can be out there and doing all the good stuff that we, for example, did this week. It goes together, personal holiness and social holiness. They need to come together, especially if you are a Mary all over the place. And she did. And it works. Oh, it's preparing her big time. Watch this. Because in a little while, as disaster strikes, we just mentioned it, and as her brother would die, the beloved Lazarus, remember? And Jesus was not there anymore. The one who suddenly remembers, I studied the feet of Jesus. She's on her feet. She's not sitting in the house and waiting, and it's so sad that brother Lazarus died. She's on the way. She's running. She's racing. Remember my marathon runner? Probably with good shoes. Maybe she has got the shoes on of Jesus, even if they feel like they're a shoe size too big, and it's overwhelming. What do we do now in the middle of death hitting her family? That's the provider in the family. The man in the household just died. She's running to meet Jesus halfway, and she's landing. You can look it up later. Guess where? In front of his feet. Yeah. Sitting at Jesus' feet. Later, the same thing again. Learning again, confronting him, and said, my brother just died. And I know one day when we're all in heaven, she's catching up about the message of Jesus Christ, who's got big plans for Mary and Martha, for everybody out there, that it's going to come together. And when that is done, wasn't there a story about a lady, a rebellion, that broke all the rules and anointed the feet of Jesus for his burial before he would go to Golgotha? That was Mary. Remember? Trying it with her hair, completely inappropriate. Because she had learned it from sitting at the feet of Jesus. Martha, Martha, Mary needs that. She needs to sit right there so that she can study and get prepared for these days. When everything's done, and Golgotha happened, but it's Easter morning, can you do some recollection of your memories with me? Who is the first one who's leaving the unlocked room out of that shock, disaster, everything upside down, and who's racing to the grave, nothing to fear anymore? Who is it? That's Mary. I'm pretty sure by now she has the shoes on of Jesus Christ. And it's not only one way, right? She's going there, and she sees angels, one sitting at the foot of where his body was, and she hears the instructions, and she's racing back, right, to get the disciples. And with them, she's going back, following them. Remember that little race competition? Standing outside, staying there. And when everything's done and she figured out in the end that it's not to the gardener, that's Jesus Christ calling her by name, Mary. Mary. She will go back. That's four times if I counted right. She must have had good shoes. She must have had some conditions by that time. Who would have thought that the most contemplative prayer warrior, Mary, sitting at the feet of Jesus, will be the biggest marathon cross-country racer that was ever there, to go back and now tell everybody, including you and I, that Jesus is alive. Praise be to God. When I started serving in my first church, my old mentor, I mentioned him once in a while, Hans Wilhelm, he's now in his 90s, and we're still in contact, who trained me through the practical stuff of being a pastor. He would come to my ordination service, and afterwards he said, and make sure you always have good shoes on. Don't look at my shoes now. I thought that was odd. You're going to walk a lot. Ministers, missionaries, Marys, Marthas. That goes for the boys too. Make sure you have good shoes on. Make sure you study the feet and shoes of Jesus Christ for the challenges that he's going to put us in that we do not select. I can witness to that just looking over the last week. But he will equip us. Martha, Martha, Marys, stay at my feet. Study. And watch and be filled with that strength and the knowledge, the equipment that you need so that you can race and stay in contact with me all the time. And then we're going to move mountains. And then it's not anymore this contemplation, where there's more action. I want a mission church. I want a praying church. That's, excuse me, baloney. It's a Mary Martha. It's a both church. In order to move mountains, we need to sit at the feet of Jesus. And with that and through that, God's going to move us and give us exactly what we can handle for that day. Right, Gail? Yeah. Have a little talk with Jesus. So when you ask me how did last week go, I don't want you to know all the details. But what touched me most, he touched me, is to know that 80 high schoolers, this is 16, 17-year-olds, you didn't get to encounter them here in the worship service last Sunday. But after that, you know, on Friday they went to Wet n Wild, and suddenly the ones who were here from our church said, where is everybody, right? We just got used to the whoosh, noise level and action and vibes and energies and the joy and the passion. We're going to change the world. I asked him on Saturday night, Dorothy and Jim were with us, do you remember what TOW stands for? Turn over the world, right? They were there. They knew it. Transformation of the world. That's our mission. But what touched me most is like after every full day, whether they built ramps, whether they were fixing a roof down at El Cavario area, whether they were handing and preparing out the food, whether they were witnessing and embracing the family who was mourning for the father who had died in our garden, whether we're doing vacation Bible school or helping in that garden. They were hard workers this week. After every day, they would meet here in the church. I don't think it was optional. But they were not here dragging their feet. They were tired. They were worshiping. They were sitting at the feet of Jesus. So long story short, Martha, we owe you an answer. It's easy, right? Let's do it like in our home. Tuesdays and Thursdays, that's Mary's time to take out the dishes out of the dishwasher. And Wednesdays and Mondays, it's Martha Day. That's how we do it in our home. I don't tell you who's getting away without anything. Yeah. But you can talk to George later. It's about sharing everything. But wherever we are, it's about staying in touch with Jesus Christ. And then we can make it through the cross, through Easter morning, witnessing an empty tomb and telling the whole world around us, he's risen. He's risen indeed. We're making disciples of Jesus Christ for TOW, for the transformation of the world. And the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit will be with us now and forevermore. Amen. Would you pray with me? Lord, it's not an either or. I'm so grateful to be reminded this morning that no matter which activities we carry, whether it's a very quiet ministry, taking care of that one neighbor, that one family member at home 24/7, or whether it's being out there and everybody adores us for how much energy and how much motions we're bringing to the table. You don't measure it that way. You say, whatever you do, I want you to sit at my feet and do it as a disciple of me. And out of that personal holiness, being fed by me, being loved by me, being filled by me, I will equip you that you can run the race, that you can run a marathon, and that you'll always meet me halfway and sit at my feet for a minute and cry it out and ask all the questions and get new directions and forgiveness. So we're so grateful, oh God. We commit ourselves today that everything, every moment in our life, whatever we plan to do for today, we want to do it through the blessing of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, that you would take and cut out everything that has nothing to do with it, and that we are not getting only a knowledge about it, but a habit, the rebellions, and the ones who are the ladies, and the masters of the house, that we're in need of that direction to tell the whole world, the Lord is risen. He's risen indeed. And to you be the glory now and forever. Amen.
Amen. Church, as you're able, let's sing.
Church, the worship is over. The service is starting. Go into this wonderful week with God's great blessing. May the Lord watch over your comings in and goings out from this day and forevermore. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.